Gentlemen, last name. My daddy was a cow. And my hood daddy, he was one of them little lizard horn spider thing. I was born among rocks and tumbleweed. I did not see water till I was a grown man, and I was a grown man, ladies and gentlemen, long before I was born. I wandered lands far and wide, tall and low. I survived hurricanes, I survived droughts, I survived storms, blizzards. I even, ladies and gentlemen, survived them damn Democrats. Even after they took my gun! But nothing, I tell thee nothing, compares to the time that I shot stinking Abraham Lincoln. Who I'd be set, you might not know this, but I'd be set in this very room. I'd be watching a theater play. I'd be sitting right where you're sitting now, my good man. And then I'll move right over there where you're sitting, my good woman. And then I went and got myself a beer, and I realized they deal with, by the way, I was sitting the first time. This fella in a bad dog, top head, don't sit down in front of me. I said, hell, boy, if you don't move that head of yours, I'm gonna shoot you right there. This would be the time before the two way my gun. And do you think that he would move? I tell thee, he did not. So what I do, I pull out my gun that I have now lost. I dead pointed straight at his head. I looked him in the back of his head. And bang, I shot him dead. There'll be a song written about this here occurrence. My name, ladies and gentlemen, is Don Wilkes Booth. We are about to play the song entitled Booth Shot.
Hope you like our music. Very good. It's even more places on front if you want to hear even better. Unfortunately, we don't have the speakers. But that's one perk of being a Spellmannslag or play folk band is that we don't need speakers or anything to make music. So I like that. What the? No. It's you know, on a conference like this, it's nice to talk to everyone. You might use different languages and those things. But one thing that we know in this group is that the most useful language or currency that is not English or Norwegian, that is beer. So let's get the party started. So let's do not place Lombada.
This one? Okay. Thank you very much. We will end our concert now with one song. Hope you enjoyed it. With your food. Must be a wonderful combo, I think. So we'll play Jerv I Sekken. Jerv is, what does Jerv mean?
Wolverine
in the bag.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Snausdrinder, if I pronounce it correctly, and welcome to a drum session of Eurocrip 2022.
Yes, welcome. Carson said. So do you want to go over the roles?
Well, I think the first thing that would be nice to have would be the slides.
Yes.
Ah.
Oh, beautiful.
Wow. Well, I think there are a few things that you were supposed to announce.
Oh, yes. I've been told to announce the location of three things, none of which I've visited. So there's drinks upstairs, there's food on this level, and there's bathrooms downstairs. Please, no follow-up questions.
So how is this going to work today?
So if your name is on the slide, you should probably be somewhere over there. And if your name is on the bottom left, right?
Right
of the slide, you should line up behind the folks in front of you.
So over there, you don't see all. So there you don't see all right now. And if your name is on the right, down here, then please stand behind all or whoever else is standing there then at that time.
And there's also programs. I don't know if you guys found them. They should be on the doors and they're online. So if you submitted a talk, you're somewhere on this program, maybe figure out roughly where on the program and get emotionally ready to cue and take your turn.
Yes. Well, you will get this fantastic device that allows you to, you know, move slides forward and backward. And you have a amount of time allotted to you, which you can see on the program and which we know.
And which is exactly the amount of time you asked for. So.
And so what will happen if somebody runs over time?
So we have Magnus the Magnificent or the Mighty.
I think Magnus the Mighty. Are you there, Magnus? If you will go over time, Magnus will get you down from the stage. You can choose to extend your time, though. We have heard that licorice, salty licorice, is very popular in Scandinavia and nowhere outside of it. So you can buy yourself some 30 seconds extra by grabbing into one of these fantastic bags and get you some disgusting licorice. Is there anything else that we need to mention?
I guess let's see how it goes.
Well, then the first today are our fantastic program chairs for this conference, Ol and Stefan. Please take it away.
Which of the mics? This one? Good evening, Trondheim. So thank you very much, everyone, for coming. And here is the program chair's report, part one. So first of all, we would like to thank the program committee. We had 70 people on the program committee. I'm not going to mention their names one by one, besides those that are marked in red, which we'll discuss soon. If you see your name in red, this is a good time to run away. So we would like to thank the committee. They had a lot of work. 372 submissions, we'll discuss this in a second, in the middle of a global pandemic. We didn't do the statistics between the correlation between missing the reviews and catching COVID, but there seems to be some relation between the two. Left as future work. Now, besides the program committee, we also used 368 sub-reviewers. We would like to thank all of them, and I was asked to list their names one by one. So thank you very much. Yes, especially you. Thank you very much for the hard work. We couldn't have done it without you. I mean, we could have, but then we would make terrible mistakes, right?
Yes.
Happens. So really, there were a lot of discussions. We did several experiments this year. One of the experiments you've probably heard of, which was we used area chairs just like last year, but we extended their jobs. So we divided the world of ISCR into four traditional themes, and each of them had their own area chair. The real world crypto theme was actually divided randomly. This caused some issues with the real world crypto people, so we had to use another option. So it was assigned to the regular theme of the ISCR according to what was the closest thing. And then we had the area chairs taking care of the papers and helping us to sort throughout all the submissions. So their main job was to identify problematic papers of different types, papers that required extra care in the rebuttal process, papers that were way below the bar, or papers that were above the bar, and helped us to keep everything under control because we couldn't have done it without them. So here are their names. So I think we would like to give very special thanks to Sonia and Thomas, who took care of the chess submissions. FSC submissions were handled by Martijn, PKC by Nigel, and PCC by Kermit. Thank you very much. So you will see that chess, actually, and we will discuss chess a bit later, we did a lot of effort trying to bring back a bit chess into the community. I don't know, how many of you are from the chess community? Yeah, great. First of all, thank you for coming. Second of all, as some of you may know, there is a bit of a problem with the chess community, which they feel like they are not welcome in Europe. Now, it may be Joppe specifically, but we do welcome them, and we try to approach them to have more submissions, and for that we had more people from the community, of the chess community, in the program committee, and we had also two chess area chairs to make sure that we're not making any mistakes, especially not marking something which is chess as not part of Eurocrypt. And we took a lot of effort to make sure that all sub-communities of cryptographers feel welcome at ICR Eurocrypt 2022. And I hope that this tradition will follow. Another thing that we've done was we had the meeting. We actually had three meetings because of time zone issues before the review process started, where we met with the reviewers and we tried to explain what we expect out of them. And you will get, those of you interested enough, there is in the ISCR documents, there's also the reports of the program chairs. So there is going to be links over there, but we didn't make that public case because the area chairs were sort of hidden up until now. Now we also did another experiment.
Okay, so what we did was we allowed self-nomination of PC members. The reason for this was that, sometimes you have maybe younger members of the community that would like to serve for the PC and wanted to give them a chance. Also, sometimes we have more senior people who sometimes get lots of invitations and have to decline. And sometimes maybe there's a year where they feel like they feel like serving on the committee, and maybe for some accident they are not invited. So that would also give them a chance to let us simply know that they feel like being on the committee. And we had actually quite many volunteers. So we had around 45 people. So you could nominate someone or you could self-nominate yourself. We approached 29 people from the list of people who were nominated. And we all of them, of course, accepted. The acceptance rate of people who are not self-nominated was much lower, of course, 50%. And there's one more statistics. So this is statistics we just played recently. We're a little bit worried about what will be the result, but luckily, I mean, this shows that the experiment worked. So 90% of self-nominated people, or 90% of the reviews from the self-nominated people were delivered on time. For the others, for the not self-nominated people, it was 80%. So this shows that makes sense to have the self-nomination process, because in general, the reviews delivered by them are more timely.
So we would like to thank several people besides the committee and the sub-reviewers, specifically Kevin McCurley. You may have heard him today once in a while over the Zoom, Deus Ex Machina. He helped us a lot, and this guy is holding the ICR together with all the online and virtual activities, especially with the hot CRP system, which is... yeah, exactly. The ICR integration and online support, and you could send him a question and you get an answer immediately. That was amazing. Colin, thank you very much for you and the entire local team. You guys made a wonderful event. The session chairs that agreed to wear horns or something. And of course, Ty McKelly, who is also somewhere behind the scenes. So thank you very much, all of you. So far, it was just the boring stuff, right? The people like, we thank that, we thank that. Nobody listened so far, right? So here are the numbers that interest everybody. We had 372 submissions in total, 5 were withdrawn. One of them was withdrawn, and then the authors wanted to send answers to the to the committee, which was kind of weird. The order is first you send comments and then you blow up the place and walk out. This was the wrong order. 85 were accepted. We had the best paper award. You heard it yesterday. The sun never sets on the Norwegian Empire, so it was crap. And we had 2 more papers that were invited to the Journal of Cryptology. Now, as I mentioned, we had a lot of, there is an issue with CHESS, and you can see that they submitted only 18 papers. Now, this is self-marking. So each person submitting, each author submitting the paper had to clear to declare whether it's CHESS, TCC, PKC, FSC, or none of the ISCR venues. As you can see, we had a lot of those.
But some papers, I think, were also marked with the 2 tags, so that's why it doesn't sum up to 85.
Yeah, there were many papers that were tagged under multiple tags, and the summation is kind of weird. You know, cryptographers, actual numbers, doesn't really work. It's correct up to order of 1. So we would like to encourage the CHESS community to submit more papers. You see, we have, I think that we're trying to be a very good home for your submissions. Of course, and this is, again, this is what the authors of the papers marked. So if you happen to be from the CHESS community and you say, this is a theoretical paper of CHESS and not real CHESS, sorry, we didn't go and start, you know, meddling with self-identifying of people. It's, again, some Geneva Convention or something like that. These are the self-declared subcommunities. Now, here for the real statistics that you came to hear. So out of the 85 accepted submissions, 68 were uploaded to ePrint. So we looked at the year of being uploaded to ePrint. And apparently one was uploaded in 2019, 5 in 2020, 33 in 2021, and 29 only in 2022. Now you can ask yourself, was acceptance actually somehow related to that. So actually only 22 of these papers were uploaded to ePrint before the deadline. I think that 2019 and 2020 for sure. Another 19 were uploaded in between. So this gives you the rankings, give or take. For comparison, we randomly sampled 20 rejected papers. Hopefully it was a correct sampling, learning errors with something. So you get very similar statistics. So 13 were not uploaded. It seems there is no correlation between posting before the submission deadline and getting accepted. However, it seems that there are 17 authors that believe that they shouldn't upload to ePrint. Now, do you have the bell for shame? Please upload to ePrint. Seriously, this is. Okay, so some more interesting statistics. The correlation of acceptance with the title length is negative. So shorter is better. The abstract length is, this is below the statistical significance, but slightly, there is some correlation, small. We need to sample more papers. There is a number of authors. There's actually strong correlation with that. And the more the merrier, obviously. And here's the statistic that baffled me, which is the number of PC conflicts. So on behalf of the next year's Euro Crypto Committee, I'm asking you not to tick all the PC members as in conflict, because then there is a problem of trying to find someone to review your paper. And of course, these two can be also very problematic to some extent, obviously. Okay, apparently we're not very efficient community. In the title, we don't have a lot of efficiency, also not in the abstract. Practical, well. Quantum, yeah, slight increase. Apparently we don't implement that much. The letter E is not very popular. Now, probably many of you would like to have more statistics, and we're going to release all the data for further analysis, obviously. However, it contains very confidential and sensitive information, so we're going to follow the GDPR and the ICR expectations, and we're just going to do everything differentially private. There's only one problem, we're not expert on that. So we're looking for volunteers. If you know some delta and epsilon values, that come to see us afterwards. Now, one thing to remember that we made an impact. The fact that nothing is practical nor efficient doesn't mean that it has to be non-impact. And let's be honest. Do you really care what's the difference between multi-party computation primitives, multi-party computation OT, multi-party? We just gave it numbering system. And as you can see, there are 5 sessions on that. Nigel, are you happy? You can see.
No, not here.
Yeah, okay. So, and thanks to Nadim for the wonderful tweet. Now, we would like to finalize the presentation with 2 not thanks, actually things that we do not like to think about. The first one of them is, of course, COVID. This made everything a bit more complicated, especially as I caught it in the middle of the discussion. So suddenly you have to do this without coughing on the computer because I didn't want to infect Stefan.
I got it after the notification.
Yeah. And another guy that we would like not to thank actually caused us a lot of trouble. I'm not going to read the ISCR statement on that, but actually there were several impacts of the war in Ukraine, also on the committee work. And that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. So My name is Borde Kok, and I'm going to be talking about investment opportunities in the cinematic universe of Christopher Lee. It's really nice to see all of you here. I live here, I work here at NTNU, and it's been a blast having you all here in town. You know, one of the most fun things about crypto conferences is, of course, looking on Twitter, because people share everything, especially since it's here where we live and thrive. It's fun to see what everyone is on about. So I don't know, I don't normally like people sharing pictures of my house on the internet, but sure, okay. This one thing, yeah, okay, fanning about Karsten, yeah, that's also allowed, I guess. Complaining about airlines, what would conferences, haven't we missed conferences, people? That's fine. Pre-ordering Severin Films, the Eurocrypt of Christopher Lee Collection 2, the Blu-ray, right? What? Tweet from 2 days ago, a tweet from yesterday, the Eurocrypt of Christopher Lee box set. Finally, get, so what is this? Okay, the Eurocrypt of Christopher Lee Collection 2 is shipping started yesterday. Apparently, I swear I'm not making this up. This was released yesterday. I don't know if there are fans of Christopher Lee in the audience. Good for you. Why now? Apparently, this is the centennial week of Christopher Lee. He would have become 100 years old this weekend. So that's really nice. But it makes me wonder, what is now the worth of a $95 box set? Seems like a lot. Well, actually, that's interesting that you ask, because I'm getting paid in Norwegian kroner, the worth of the $95 box set has increased a lot. So if you pre-ordered it in early April, you did well. Your 840 kroner box set became a 940 kroner box set. So, did any of you buy anything for maybe $850 around the start of April? Because what is your crypto space really worth? Well, actually, it was really smart to pre-register early April, because then you had roughly like 7,300 kroners worth of Eurocrypt, and now it's 8,400 kroners worth of Eurocrypt. What does this mean? Well, the beer was actually even more expensive last month. The sponge cake, we will get cake later, small spoiler, it's inflated completely. We had two free beers at the reception. You think that was little? It was even less. Live music to dance for, we saw something now. We had like 10 minutes. We could increase this to 30. There will be an amazing after party later also that we have been able to afford because of this. So that's great. And also some things not related to food, I guess. Let's compare this to other crypto events, shall we? Conclusion. What do fans of Christopher Lee and the people in this room have in common? We are the only people in the world profiting off of crypto. I thank you very much.
I'm supposed to click. Yes? No?
Yes.
Okay. A thesis to remember. So I want to share with you several good news. So my little baby Joanna Vesian Duca has graduated from newborn. She's now a baby thanks to validating her thesis, which I would like to present to you now. So it's very important, you know, academic world is hard. So I think it's important to start very early. So she proposed a thesis on circulability, trying to classify things by measuring them using her mouse, palato-labial, technical word. It's not so much about crypto, unfortunately. So she proposed a systematic study of circling properties of things and doing first-hand experiments. And first mouse experiments, she reached a few conclusions and even some conjecture toward the standard model. So she identified three
three binary properties of things. So are they warm or cold? Are they smooth or fibrous? Are they milky or not? And depending on those three properties, she's able to identify, classify six different things in this world. Some things are not exactly stable in time, she noted. She's not sure what to do with that. Then she moved on to a little bit of theorization. So she proposed a few axioms. The first one is that warm is preferable to cold, smooth is preferable to fibrous, and milky is preferable to dry. And from those axioms, she can deduce a certain amount of conclusions, which is kind of obvious. I take solace in the second one, that is preferable to pacifier, because the pacifier is cold and warm. However, me and the bottle are incomparable, because the bottle is cold, but the bottle is milky. So, too bad. So she presented her thesis in front of a prestigious jury composed of Daniel Ladouche, Alice Pellet-Marie, Melissa Rossi, Tancred Lepoint, Benjamin Velowski, and Damien Stélé, who all sent, not all of them actually, sent very nice reviews. And the thesis was validated. She also is thinking of her future work. So she noted that the model seems kind of incomplete. In particular, she has not yet found something that would be warm, fibrous, and milky. So she's going to do more research on that. Another question is the classification unique? Or would there exist things that are distinct but have the same circulability properties? And finally, obviously, finding for cryptographic application is a big open problem I'm trying to suggest here. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Elizabeth Kreitz, and I want to share with you today something that I've been thinking a lot about recently, which is multi-party Schnorr signatures. So why do people care about Schnorr signatures right now? There's been a lot of research in this area, and it's primarily due to the fact that Bitcoin is now incorporating Schnorr signatures into its protocol. This was part of the Taproot upgrade that occurred in November of last year. And in particular, it's desirable to have a signature where multiple different parties can sign, for example, a given financial transaction. It's also desirable that when multiple parties sign, the signature that is output at the end looks exactly like single party Schnorr. So with my co-authors, Chelsea Conlow and Mary Maller, we do the following. So first we introduce a three-round Schnorr multi-signature, which is simple music. We also introduce a three-round threshold signature called simple T-sig. Now we prove these secure under the discrete logarithm assumption in the random oracle model only, and we also achieve concurrent signing. We also introduce a variant of the MUSIC 2 two-round multi-signature and a variant of the two-round threshold signature FROST. So the variant of MUSIC 2 incorporates proofs of possession, and it's more efficient basically because you can multiply all of the different users' public keys together to form a joint key, but without any rogue key attacks. The original version of FROST had a proof that relied on heuristic assumptions. So in particular, with our version of FROST, FROST 2, we're able to prove it secure under the one more discrete logarithm assumption in the random oracle model only. FROST 2 is a more efficient version of FROST in that it reduces the number of exponentiations from T to 1. I should mention also that the multi-signatures incorporate proofs of possession. So this is for key generation. And we introduce a KOE assumption called Schnorr KOE and prove it in the AGM plus the random oracle model. Note that the algebraic group model here is used only for key generation. So in particular, you could switch out a distributed key generation protocol and not use the AGM. However, The Schnorr-Kaewi assumption allows us to achieve a tight reduction. Our work on FROST 2 is being incorporated into the next CFRG standardization draft. And as part of the standardization through NIST for these threshold signatures. Also, our work will appear in crypto this year, so you'll be able to hear a longer version of this talk. But if you're interested in this topic, please come find me. I'm happy to chat more about it. Thank you.
Good night, John Hay. I need a quick thing, you know. I'm here to do some shameless propaganda about starting to work. I'm not loud enough. So, our shameless propaganda of the night, we're doing another event in Scandinavia. Me and Gus are organizing a summer school on privacy preserving machine learning, and that will take place in the first week of August. If that's your first time in Scandinavia and you're a bit appalled by the prices of beer, do not worry. Copenhagen is very much more affordable than here. We will be providing drinks and cigars and good stuff for a good price. We have a great speaker lineup with people covering the differential privacy, FHE, MPC, and federated learning. And we have the best ice cream in Copenhagen right next to the venue. So that was my shameless plug. Thanks and see you later.
Yeah, hello everyone. We are, we have lots of co-authors, and we're talking about the traveling salmon problem, and we'll make a deep dive into post-plankton cryptography. And so we'll get right into it. So a bit of motivation. Why should we consider this? Well, we are all in Norway, and there's lots of salmon, and we've also seen lots of salmon at the menu at the hotel. And if you learn things about salmon, then you learn, well, they migrate over the year. And that leads to some problems, because if you migrate, you're on the way, and then you might get to lunch buffet, but not as an eater. So the salmons want to go around and they want to communicate with each other, because then you can coordinate, but that leads to problems. See the lunch buffet. So what we consider is the traveling salmon problem. And here we have a specimen. And of course, if you have such a nice problem, then we as cryptographers want to find a solution. So how can we build cryptographic protocols to solve this problem? And that's what we are going to talk about.
All right, so thank you very much. First of all, I want to talk about some sunk approaches, since not everything works in cryptography, right? So the most natural approach would actually be herring-friendly elliptic curves, right? I mean, they lend naturally to that problem. They have some very well-known properties, right? So they're well-seasoned, they are lightweight, and they allow for tight security reductions with sharp upper bounds. However, they also come with a set of problems, right? So they are very slippery and they're not post-plankton secure. So we had to come up with a different solution for that. And that's
good. Yeah, so I'm too short actually. Yeah, so we had also the affiliated event of CB Crypto. So we thought that we could maybe use some techniques from there. So we thought of resolvement codes, but actually they didn't fit very well. So we designed new codes, which are called resolvement codes. So what is a resolvement code? I mean, actually, we don't consider finite fields here. We use floats because they are much cooler. And well, we don't use floats. In general, we use a yellow submarine of floats, which we call S. Then we define the resolvement code as the evaluation of fish one up to fish n. And they are actually pretty nice codes, but the caveat is that the code size is large and they are inefficient. I mean, come on. Okay. So we put some effort in these codes and we figured out that there is a corollary that we could show. And that says that if we shrimp the parameters of our code C, we will end up with a code C star that actually has optimal bait. So we really can work with that.
All right, this is an amazing construction, but we still have some open problems for you to work on. No? Yeah, so of course, if we consider new codes, we also have to look at attacks because that whole thing might be insecure. And of course, if we talk about reef salmon codes, the assumptions are a bit fishy. So what attacks do we consider? Well, first, manual attacks. And of course, the thing to do are angular attacks. But this is a bit tedious and takes a lot of time. So we considered automating them. And of course, then we used neural networks because that's the thing to do with salmons. And these attacks are quite efficient, but not efficient enough to break them. So we still want to use them. But of course, there are still some problems. Okay, so we think we can add some salt and vinegar to make them more secure. And we believe that we can have an extension to threshold signatures. Also, we want to solve the phishing attacks, and we still haven't finished our implementation and benchmarking. Okay, then I can wrap up with some conclusion. We presented our salmon-based cryptography. It's fresh, it's tasty, it's post-plankton secure. And if you're wondering what is the set of real-world applications, then...
Mike. Okay. Oh, I have my mic. Quick announcement for the speakers. Please leave the slides on the title slide of the next speaker so that the speaker following them can see their name and be ready. And also for the speakers, I guess to let you guys know that you have 1 minute left, maybe Carson and I will wave a fork vaguely threateningly at you. Exactly.
Oh, okay, now, it's hard act to follow. So sorry, it is a technical thing, but it's a very classic problem and it's easy. So maybe it's okay. Propose something called, there's an ideal cipher on groups. It's a very useful thing to have. We give something that is incredibly close to it. And it's based on a beautiful construction of McCoy, Rosuek, and Roy, and I will explain the difference. So here is ideal ciphers on groups. Who cares? So there's this classic protocol by Belov and Merritt, key exchange, encrypted key exchange. You can authenticate using a password by running a key exchange, and the only thing you do, you encrypt every message under your password. Your counterparty decrypts under their password, and so you communicate, you complete everything if your passwords are the same. And Bellare, Poincheval, and Rockaway pointed out, proved that this is secure if the key exchange has random messages, like for example, Diffie-Hellman, and the cipher is an ideal cipher. Now, what does it mean, an ideal cipher? It's a box that keeps permutations for every key, and we have passwords here, just as keys. And in a forward direction, it gives you random ciphertext. In a backward direction, it gives you random plain text. And it's a fantastic object to use in proofs because it has collision resistance because everything is random that comes out of it. It commits to inputs. They are straight line extractable. You can embed challenges. So it's a fantastic thing. And but we need it on groups, so you cannot use like a yes because you are encrypting group elements, so not every bit string is a group element. So it solves beautifully password authentication problem, but then all password work came out because it was hard to implement. This ideal cipher on groups, nobody knew really how to implement them nicely. So there is a bunch of solutions. You don't have to You know, you can read it if you'd like, but the really exciting one is the last one by McCoy, Ruslek, and Roy, who pointed out, okay, if you have Feistel, we know that 8 rounds of Feistel give you an ideal cipher. And if one Feistel wire is a Colt's group element, and you replace XOR by a group operation, and a hash is a hash onto a group, you will implement ideal cipher on groups. So what's wrong with this? It's just it has 4-8 rounds. So you do a lot of hashing onto a curve. And these guys showed that actually you don't need 2 rounds, surprisingly, suffices for application like encrypted key exchange. So the only thing is that they model it with game-based objects, and it gets very hairy. That they managed to prove this, it's very hard. And there is something in the proof, it's like they abstract it in certain ways that we don't find perfect. It's a little hard, but we still believe that actually the proof goes through if you, for the particular construction, but not when you abstract it the way you do. So what do? We simplify, we strengthen their construction, so it actually becomes a UC randomized ideal cipher. And then everything falls much easier. And what's the difference? Here is the Feistel, and here is our modification. This wire holds group elements, so this is not an XOR. This is a group operation, and this hash is a hash onto a group. And we basically, it has funky malleability properties that are hard to work with. If we put stick, replace this XOR with a bitwise ideal cipher, all malleability goes away and a simulator gets straight line stuff. So, you know, okay.
Oh. Hello, it's me again. So, you know, we've all thought it. We've all felt it. There are too many conferences. Let's look at the ISER website. Eurocrypt. Okay, fair enough. AsiaCrypt. Okay, fair enough. EmptySet Crypto. Don't know that one. PKC. Don't know that one. What do half of these even mean? Asia. Does anyone really believe we're going to Asia ever again? I don't really know. So. The community is divided. Europe, Asia, what about the rest of the world, guys? Has no one thought of them? So I have a solution that can be the model for crypto conferences of the future. One conference, Pangea Crypt. And you know, Pangea Crypt, you know, okay, nice. Are there not? I was thinking, do we really have enough with one conference? Are there not more problems we should fix? Maybe yes, because what is crypto? I ask you, what is it? This shit? No. Pangea Crypt will be a cryptocurrency-free zone. So I was thinking, okay, but these people exist as well, I guess. What do we do with the cryptocurrency? So I've been thinking, what is, you know, okay. Can we not give back to the community? Final solution will be 2 conferences. So we will have Pangea Crypt, and it will be a safe space, but not for those people. Is this the best solution ever? I think so. Less confusion, less intercontinental travel, if they're, you know, it's non-continent, less division, round us up, you know, improvements, and more unity. I thank you, I'll be here all week.
Well, thanks very much to the speakers of the first session. Let's give them a round of applause again. And now we have a break of, let's say, 20 minutes until 8:35, maybe 8:40.
We're actually shockingly on time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyways, have some beer, have some food. See you all again at 8:40.
For the first time, all this seemed to be happening again. Yes, and so it seems that we have met before and laughed before and loved before. I'll find you in the morning sun, and when
Hello, guys, we're looking for Nadim or carry on drinking, but Nadim or please come help us. Thank you.
In every lovely summer's day, in everything that's left and dear, I'll always think of you that way. I'll find you in the morning sun, and when the night is but I'll be
and those in the inside.
Thank you. The skies of deep blue. Each time I look
and I guess all
Hello. All right, guys, we're about to resume with the second session of our REM session. So, four announcements, which I'm going to struggle to remember. The first announcement is, so each of you received three drinks tickets, but you can actually buy more drinks even when you run out for something like 90 something Norwegian kronas. I don't remember the exact amount. The second unrelated announcement is Karsten and I have a new way for you guys to buy more time for your presentation. And that is, if you buy both rum session chairs a drink, you get 2 minutes. All right. The third announcement is, okay, someone left a laptop and I have claimed it. Oh, it's Eduardo's. Great. It's not Eduardo's. Okay, if you don't claim your laptop, I'm going to give it to Eduardo. So please come get your laptop. And the fourth announcement is, at some point, and we're not going to tell you when, but at some point, there's going to be cake and coffee where the food was. But we're not going to tell you when, because we don't want a mass exodus from this really fun rum session. All right, and now we're going to have a remote talk.
Yeah, let me... Where's the clicker?
I think it's over there.
No. Oh, yeah. Okay. So, here we go. So we wrote on the website for the rum session that there are not going to be any remote talks, but those folks have submitted it and promised to be here, but then didn't make it on time, which is they couldn't be bothered. I guess we're now going to show the video that they want to contribute to the rum session. Audio? Like, you know, for the
ideal functionality of a bridge between Trondheim from Book Paradigm. The basic problem we try to tackle is for Alice to go from Trondheim, represented as A, to the island B, also known as Munkholmen. The ideal functionality of a bridge between Trondheim and Munkholmen is a portal. Then Alice can teleport instantly from A to B. A vocally close construction of the ideal bridge is a regular bridge. While possibly expensive, it allows Alice to get to B without getting wet. However, the bridge construction is susceptible to a Chidmore troll in the middle attack. Trolls supposedly serve it to live on bridges. One way to mitigate the troll in the middle attack is to not have a bridge. We make the sensible assumption that trolls can't swim. If there is any evidence of the contrary, please let us know. Without the bridge, another construction is called boat. It uses a concave-shaped object generating lift using buoyancy by decreasing the average local density. One issue of our boat construction to realize the ideal bridge is delay distinguishability. It takes considerably longer for Malice to get to the island by boat than walking over a bridge. To address the delay, we compile our boat protocol with the groundbreaking construction of Ogremsky 22. If you drink enough before the boat trip, Alice arrives without memories of the trip and the delay is not noticeable anymore. In summary, the boat protocol compiled with Ogremsky teleportation is indistinguishable to the ideal bridge. The distinguishing advantage is smaller than 2 to the minus k, where k is the blood death in all concentration. To show practicability, we performed an empirical boat study. A is close to the Eurocrypt conference venue and B is Munkholmen on top. Unfortunately, the Ogremsky teleportation is not feasible in Norway due to prohibitive monetary overhead. Once close enough, B can be inspected from the boat. To strengthen our claim, we encourage replication studies. The boat leaves every hour and costs 110 NOK. Please post your results so we can compare and improve our observations.
Thanks very much to Sally, whoever that was. Next up, this one a bit more serious. There's going to be a quick announcement also via video about IndoCrypt 2022. Please, can we have the video?
Hello, this is short announcement about the conference IndoCrypt 2022. This time it will be held in Kolkata from December 12 to 13. So this is just after Asia trip. It will be in hybrid mode. Professor Vimal Kumar Roy and Mr. Jaydev Bhattacharya will be general chairs. Myself, Santanu Sarkar, and Takanadi Ichobe will be program chairs. Professor Somaya Moitra is the organizing chair. There are 52 program committee members from diverse fields of cryptology. Submissions on any cryptographic topic are welcome. Please note down, submission deadline is on September 1st, so 1 week after ACFIP notification, and conference will be from December 12 to 14. This time it will be in Kolkata. Kolkata is the city of joy. There are many tourist spots in Kolkata, like Victoria Memorial Hall, Dakshineswar Temple, etc. Darjeeling is also not far from Kolkata. You may also go there and enjoy Darjeeling tea. So ACFIP is in Taipei City. You can come to Kolkata, stay a few days there, and return back to your own place. Yeah, that's all. See you at InnoCrypt 2022.
Hi, it's a beautiful night. Sorry for one more boring presentation, but I know there are so many MPC researchers. There are 5 sessions in Eurocrypt for MPC, so maybe more of you can enjoy this presentation. Recently, I'm just wondering about, is cuckoo hashing secure? Let's take a look. It's just a question, but I don't know. My name is Sungwan Kim, and let's see. What is cuckoo hashing? Most of you I know, so we skip the details. It's just one ball per one bin, and it is used for efficient MPC protocols. Let's think about like almighty PSI protocols. There's a God with set X and Alice with set Y, and God do cuckoo hashing for set X and do give the intersection to Alice. It's with almighty powers. Then Alice want to know about which elements God have. And there's an attack of Alice. So Alice runs hashes and find the tuple of X's. So there are HIs and X are collided in all the X HI. Then Alice know at least one of the X's are not in X. Then is this attack powerful? Then you think it is powerful or not? Assuming uniform distribution of X, it is the statistical distance is bounded about cuckoo fail probability. For example, it's 2 to the power of minus 40 in PSI context. So can we assume uniform distribution? Usually we cannot, because real world data does not follow the uniform distribution. It's like blood pressure or height, age, does not follow the uniform distribution. So it is okay, I don't know. So I want your thoughts, and please give your thoughts. Thank you. Please contact me.
Hello, everyone. So this is a serious talk as well. I'm sorry for that. So this is about what cryptographer says versus what they really mean. So the first is when they write, we refer the reader to the full version of the paper for the full proof. What it really means is that you will never see the whole book. The second one is that the proof easily followed. The deadline is in 10 minutes. At the moment, I'm writing this when you read the review. So the work X, Y, Z seems related, but it's not cited, discussed. How dare you not to cite my paper? There are only three more to go. So it's a list of six. I couldn't come up with anything better. So in the beautiful or groundbreaking work of full names of the authors, either X, Y, or Z. Usually one of those is in the committee. Our work do I really need to show the our work has implications on blockchain. Our work has no relation with blockchain. The last one. Let's take the question offline. I have no idea what you asked. Thank you very much.
Hello. Do you hear me? Yes. This will be a very short announcement of CHESS 2022. If you haven't been to the membership meeting or you haven't checked the website of CHESS and you are from the CHESS community, and even if you're not, it's good to know that CHESS will be not in China, unfortunately, because of all the situation around COVID, but it will be fortunately in Leuven. And I can promise you a few things, lots of Belgian beer, no coupons, no tickets needed, a lot of delicious food. Lots of delicious food, and of course, not the last thing, a very good program that will be made up from all of you and all of us from the CHESS community, with a lot of papers which will contain words like efficient implementations and energy efficient and all of those things that we miss in Eurocrypt apparently. So it will be between 18 and 21st of September, and there will be also the day before the teaser workshop, which is topics in hardware security in RISC-V. Please come physically. It will be also hybrid, but we would like to see you there. And
hi, everyone. Cheers. It's also a short announcement talk, but it's really one slide only. So we're organizing a workshop on foundations and applications of asset-based cryptography with Erin Hales, who's also a co-organizer. She's here somewhere. So please talk to either of us about it. Also, Joe Roll is not here. We have a variety of excellent speakers, none of whom are on this slide. Sorry. I put this together very quickly. We only have a few slots remaining, but please do register for information, see either of the two websites. So thank you. Look forward to seeing you in Edinburgh. All right, thanks.
Hello. And sorry, this is one of these boring talks where I shill my latest result. So recently, I came across this notion called incompressible encryption, where this is just standard public key encryption, but the goal of an adversary is to take a ciphertext and somehow compress it into something shorter. And then later, he's being given both this hint of the ciphertext and the secret key. And his goal is to find out what was encrypted there. And it's secure if he has no clue. Now, the only reason I'm standing here is that the good people of the Eurocrypt PC asked me to chair a session today where this paper out of all, this incompressible cryptography paper out of all appeared in the obfuscation session. And I wondered why. And apparently the reason seems to have been that the authors constructed this thing called RAID 1 incompressible PKE, where the ciphertext is just slightly larger than the message it encrypts from indistinguishability obfuscation, or these really complex and what? Okay, yeah. My point is this talk really didn't belong into this session because obfuscation is really not necessary for this task. So we're going to present is a new approach to first do this incompressible symmetric key encryption first, which you can build from standard primitives like or standard assumptions like LWE and DCR. And just given hash proof systems, you can turn this into a RAID 1 incompressible PKE. Coming to an ePrint near you soon. Thank you.
Hello again. I'm now here to talk about the bone triples result, which is a result that should concern all of you very deeply. You are all currently using that result, even if you're not aware of it. So let's start with a brief recapitulation on how to use bone triples to get rich in the Nordics. But like Michele said, I need to cite the right people to get this accepted. So let's start with the right citations. So we have this nice guy, Don, who created his triples back then. And then these other people who made it very famous, and this other guy who implemented it and made things that are like frustrating for a theoretician like me. But well, they also make some nice software packages that make this stuff work. So I would actually call it that triple, the happy triple, not the beeper triple, even though I love the guy. Now we get to the main subject matter here, which is the bone triples. This kind of bone, no. Do not associate me to those. Those are highly illegal. I don't want to do legal stuff. I just want to get drunk like a normal person does. Now, this is the bone triple. Forget about Bitcoin, forget about Ethereum, forget about your favorite pyramid scheme. This is the next big thing. So hit me up for investment advice. It's $1,000 an hour. I'll give you one free right now. I can predict that in the next hour, the value of the bone triple is gonna go up considerably. So it is extremely scarce. You should hodl. Weak hands drink. I've always been a weak hand. Strong hands will hodl until the next hour. To have an idea of the bone crypto, in relation to normal prices. This is where the bone triple is. This is a chart of prices of stuff in Norway. The bone triples are situated in the first brackets, while the place where we actually have a roof over our heads is in the second. So you see, bone triples are more valuable than a hotel. I tried to do some research into pre-processing the bone triple. So the first result I had on that was 10 years ago when I bought this hip flask after realizing that the alcohol in Norway is extremely expensive. Then this year I thought I would come prepared, but we're not allowed to bring them in. Anyway, I would like to finish by citing a poem by Kipling. If you know the poem, you're gonna appreciate the idea. But the final lessons from the bone triple is, well, a bottle might be the most useful thing in this conference now. It has great practical value. It is efficient, and it can be implemented right here, right now. Did I say bring your own booze? Well, I shouldn't, because I didn't know about the impossibility results that bone triples cannot be preprocessed within this building, lest we forfeit the liquor license. Did I also mention there's TPMPC next week? I can personally guarantee it's fun. There will be beers, and they'll be cheap. And did I also mention we're doing a summer school in Copenhagen? That will also be fun, and much cheaper beers. So I like to finish with a line adapted from Kipling: an Eurocrypt is only an Eurocrypt, but a good cigar is a smoke. Thank you and good night.
Does it move by itself? No. So yes, if you are, if all this multi-party computation is too difficult, zero knowledge proof, you don't understand, and you want to do actual things, this is a serious announcement. We have a tenure track or full professor faculty position in hardware security applied cryptography. This will be a position at KU Leuven in the COSIC research group. You can find more information on the EICR website. But both junior, senior people, and we have a very light first application round on June 20. These are the people you will be working with. As you can see, maybe the balance is a bit too much towards the multi-party computations and the public keys and the crypto side. So we want to balance that again, but we have cool people, well-balanced. It's in Leuven. This is the group, or a picture from before COVID of the group. This is the, it's not a boat, but we have a view on the castle. Oops. A view on the castle. This is our lab, which you can use, and this is the building. Thank you very much.
Just a quick reminder for every speaker to do this, what I've just done. Joseph, are you around here? Otherwise, if you're not here, well, then I'll just say that there's PKC 2023 in Atlanta. Next up, Hunter.
Hi, everyone. So this is kind of a slapdash thing. It's kind of as a result of a dare, more or less. Apologies for going at the very end of this. Me and my co-authors have come up with a very important construction for you. We call it secure multi-party obfuscated talks. So the idea is it's supposed to solve one of the very main problems in cryptography, which is getting unwanted questions. This is a joint work with Ludo Poulis, Shane Gibbons, Klein Reinders, Anna Maria Kostasch, Tieran Silda, Sasha Lafia, Andy Muller, Sabu Wernig, Jesko Dubovic, and Jörg Gartner. But also, because this is such an important result, this has been done over many, many years. There's a few more acknowledgements I have to make. I have to start thanking my co-authors, Craig Gentry, Yehuda Lindell, Yosef. Leonid Dresden, Ingrid, Yevgeny, Rosario, Gennaro. Yeah, basically everybody, sorry. I'm a little nervous. I have a whole list of all the names. I was really prepared. And there's more, obviously. But also, I also have to thank to support from all of our sponsors, Apple, Google, Facebook, Intel, Netflix, Cisco, Microsoft, Research, IBM, Algorand, Zama, the Research Council of Norway, Casper, Thales, the Technology Innovation Institute, Kongsberg, Hardware, and then NIST, NSF, the FBI, CIA, NSA, AIDP, MIT, the GCHQ, NSM, PST, NIS, and FOSS. Thank you.
So we have another break. It should be around quite some time. So you have 25 minutes, and I think now the cake is also there.
By now it's likely there, yeah.
Yeah. So Get yourself some cake. See you again at 9:30.
Bye. As once more she speaks, that will do. It's spring and birds on the wing start to sing again. And it all belongs to me. It's spring again, and birds on the wing again start to sing again. It's a song of songs, and it all belongs to you and me.
Thank you. Shine high. as a mountain and deep as a river. Come rain or come shine. I guess when you met me, it was just one of those things. But don't ever let me, 'cause I'm gonna be true if you let me. You're gonna love me like nobody's loved me. Come rain or come shine. Happy together, unhappy together, and won't it be fine? Days may be cloudy or sunny. We're in or we're out of the money, but I'm with you always. I'm with you rain or shine. Thank you.
truth like love we know is discovered after time. Allows the soul to see treasures found to do with as we please. Turn our backs or choose to keep. Fill my heart, my life. Always and forever, I'll be till the world ceases to be. Will be forever.
Bad case of the blues. I've got a heartache I can't lose. I'm in love with a man who's meaner than 20 mules. Yeah. I got a bad case of the blues. I've been mistreated and abused. He never takes me nowhere. You see, he just don't care about the rules. Don't need a doctor, 'cause I'm just a poor helpless case. See the look of unrequited love I'm wearing on my pretty face. I've got a bad case of the blues. I feel so helpless and confused. But here I go back for more. Open the door. Please, 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 please. Mr. Blue.
All of me. Why not take all of me?
Hello, hello. Hello? I don't remember the lights. All right, guys, we're going to resume with our third and last session of the rap session. Yeah! So I have four announcements, and we're again at risk of me not remembering them all, but I'm doing my best. Okay, So announcement number one, I'm still holding someone's laptop. I imagine you want this. It's yours, is it really? Like really? Okay. It's dead, all right, good. Sorry. All right, one problem solved. Okay, next announcement is we have an after party. Yeah, it's here. Boys in charge. It's gonna go late into the night. It's gonna be fun. We're gonna clear some of these chairs. There's gonna be dancing, right? Boys nodding. All right, so stick around. All right, that was 2 out of 4. Number 3 is some of you guys might have seen this Queer Crypt flyer around. Queer Crypt is gonna meet right out there where the food is, right after the last session. So come meet some wonderful people. And what was the 4th one?
I don't know.
Hey. Oh, shit.
The 4th one is obviously if you have too many of the bongs, you can always donate them for charity on this table.
Yes, we're collecting bongs, guys.
What else?
No, I know. It's the voting. Okay, so we're gonna have a best rum session award. So please remember which talks you like. At the end, we're gonna go vote by volume. Vote by volume. It's a new kind of voting system to elect a winner. I think that's it.
Yeah. One more quick thing, because you only heard that 2 times tonight. There's a summer school on privacy preserving machine learning in Copenhagen. No, just kidding. Anyways, so for the next talk, this is some interesting cooperation of Nadim and all. You guys are going to. You guys have the clicker, no?
Make sounds. The sounds, there we go.
Okay, there we go.
So, hi. Eurocrypt is a great place of diversity and discovering new cultures and meeting new people. I used this opportunity, was blessed to use this opportunity at Eurocrypt 2019 to meet Orr, our colleague. I hail from, let's say, the northern Levant, and Orr hails from the southern, more southern Levant. And we were having a cordial exchange of perspectives and ideas. However, at a certain point in time, a very contentious topic was brought up. Orr had certain opinions about our hummus. Isn't that right, Mr. Dunkelman? Dr. Dunkelman.
Professor.
Professor Dunkelman. You're a student. Professor Dunkelman will enlighten us regarding his views on what he calls hummus.
Just to be clear, it's not like what Nadim is calling hummus is hummus. Like, seriously, dude, come on. Actually, I think that, you know, as part of the scientific mission of the ICR, we should probably be able to find a scientific way to measure who has better hummus. And I would like to urge, and I approach the ICR board to start a new journal, hot CRP system, hot chickpea recipe proposal.
I support science, I'm into science.
You could submit dishes, papers about the quality of your hummus. Like, I mean, there are some people who like this sort of like salty licorice or something like that, but I'm sure we can find a way.
Really, they have licorice,
right? Seriously? This licorice is as salty as your hummus.
Oh. Hey, Orr, you know, it's funny how you made excuses, because I wanted to bring hummus and we have like a tasting competition, but Orr was like, you know, so many flights, so many connections all the way from Israel to here. But you know, Orr, I've come up with an alternate solution to resolving our predicament. DJ, drop the beat.
Thank you. Cosmos was a cipher, it wouldn't just be Rock 13. It would be Rock 13 applied twice in a row.
If your Cosmos was a cipher, it would have been an Enigma machine, because it would be an Enigma who dares to touch it.
Well, your Cosmos would make a great ciphertext because it's indistinguishable from random.
Your Cosmos would never get another look at or revisit it ever.
Or, if you make Cosmos, it's exclusive or, because it's exclusive to you or no one else gonna taste it.
I would put your Cosmos in a black box and then reduce it, because this is the only thing you can do with that.
Oh my God, man. If your Cosmos recipe was a zero knowledge proof, it would be very efficient to compute because it literally contains zero knowledge.
If your Cosmos was an NPC, it would be a single player and even Bethlehem would have been corrupted.
At least we know who's the diplomatic one in this exchange, okay? Man, you making good Cosmos is so hard that it would be isomorphic to a solution to this, to the discrete logarithm problem. It's computationally intractable.
Rick claims just like his Cosmos. Seriously, your Cosmos is quantum.
Yeah, it's quantum.
Sounds like nobody wants to look inside the box to see what's inside.
Hey man, you seem to know a lot about quantum. Well, don't bother trying to use a quantum computer to make good Cosmos. I don't need to measure your Cosmos for its state to become uneatable.
Well, you know, the state of your Cosmos is so weak, you could put it inside an LFSR.
No one
filter it.
These fine academics have spent their careers coming up with obfuscation techniques. Or why don't you introduce them to your Cosmos and what it's done to obfuscate good food?
Well, the only good thing you can do with your Cosmos is put it in a box, preferably white box.
We happen to have a lot of world-class cryptographers in this room. Maybe you can ask them to cryptanalyze your Cosmos. But wait, I think that even if we give them the plain text, they still won't understand what you tried to accomplish while cooking that mess.
To be honest, I'd rather use Dual ECDBRG than eat your Cosmos.
Okay, so, I mean, I think we both know who won here, but where's the slide? Oh, I have to click on it, okay. No, that's not the right one. We sent you a new, okay, hold on, no, whatever. Anyway, there's another slide. Okay, so homoscript.org, vote now. You can literally, this is not a joke, you can open homoscript.org on your phone, on your mobile device or computer, or laptop or Turing machine, and you can start voting on who you think won the rap battle. So Orr is the South Levant option and I'm the North Levant option. Yeah, and that's Homoscript this year. Next year, we're gonna have a real Homoscript. Okay, hold on, excuse me. We're looking for judges, like we're trying to make a jury. So do apply. If you have any stake in any like Middle Eastern political issue.
I can't.
I mean,
is this like a voting? I'm not sure. Okay, fair enough. I mean, the slide, I just want to do a quick announcement. This is not going to be any deep talk here.
I'm going to, well, do shout out for CryptoBox. If you don't know what CryptoBox is, it's public key authenticated encryption. You get that from doing non-effective key exchange and then using your symmetric authenticated encryption scheme, and it's actually like real world stuff. It was, for example, implemented in the Salt library. And the announcement I have to make is that actually we have a security proof for CryptoBox. We prove PKE security for multiple instances with corruption, otherwise the instances are not really interesting. And the proof is formally verified in EasyCrypt. If you do formal verification for game-based security, there's some bonus content for you in the paper. That is how to support formal proof development with ideas from state-separating proofs. So you how to plan out your proof on paper, and then you draw these graphs, and then you get, well, you can transfer those into EasyCrypt, basically. So the paper is called Bringing State-Separating Proofs to EasyCrypt, a Security Proof for CryptoBox. It just got accepted to CSF 2022. And if you want details, the paper is on ePrint, check it out, or you can also ask me. Thank you.
How many of you like money? How many of you like research? Who want? Well, I don't know in Sweden, but you can come and try. So I'm looking for a postdoc. So if anybody of you wants to have a good salary, good wealth care, good pension, all of those things, and do fun research at Lund University, please go to that link. It's my personal webpage. There is more information about this announcement. The application is open until next week, so show your interest. And the nice thing about Lund University, it is that it has a direct train, 40 minutes, to Copenhagen Airport. Please submit your interest. Hello again. So inspired by the previous talks about Pangea Crypt, Mars, another kind of conference, we want to embrace a new phase for our community. We think that it's about time that we go to a new dimension. Therefore, we suggest to change our name to the Interplanetary Association for Cryptic Research, which will be supported by the first interplanetary conference named SpaceCrypt. As you would expect, the venue is the International Space Station. This is reachable from several spaces on Earth, and you don't have any visa issue to reach there, so that's convenient. People also speculate that COVID doesn't spread in that environment, so that could be COVID safe. We have a wide range of topic of interest, from proof of space time, post-humanity cryptography, alien resistance cryptography, Big Bang theorems, Martian party computation, plant-based cryptography, holomorphic escape velocity, and don't forget black hole reduction.
As you may have guessed, the main goal of this conference is to make the research in our field more sustainable. So we are cooperating with one of the main producer of eco-friendly cars, Tausla. We plan to reduce our emission in the next 5 years to zero, but up to 2000, now plus 5 years, I cannot count now. You can compensate your, that's stronger. You can compensate your emission by using Bitcoin, but the only problem is that there is an open problem actually, and it is how can we compensate the emission of Bitcoin. So we're waiting for some hint from you. And the second mission of our conference is to, let's say, promote diversity. So we strongly believe that aliens' rights are living being rights. So as you can see from this cute guy here. And we also decided to design new gifts, new prizes for the participants of the conference, and in particular, the best alien result. Of course, there is the conflict of interest that if you work on the same planet in the last 2 years, you cannot, well, yeah, you got it.
Next. So, as a, get some of them because I don't like licorice. So as we all know, we don't go for easy chair, hot CPR or CRP. I always forget how it is, mainly because it's quite limiting, as we know from the beginning. So, and even because we would like to have like a more modern type of technology for the submission and the proceeding. So we are planning to have like an optical way to disseminate our works. That is why we'll use the interplanetary file sharing, which is already used, but it offers us like a really powerful additional feature. Like it allows us to publish no more than five dimensional pages for all your strange imaginary hybrid proofs. Plenty of space there in the fourth and fifth dimension. We can get some quantum entangled result so that you can change whenever you publish at a certain point. Of course, we have a Klein and Möbius page support for people that are more into the theoretical side. But then, of course, we get color pages for free. Thank you. So the server, the Milky Way for, well, the majority of us, it's, well, we don't have an URL yet. But you can get it here. It's a point in space. Just go to your local space agency and get submit the paper there. But then, of course, as we saw from the membership discussion before, there's this problem of rejection. So we will, when we were thinking of how to handle this problem, I think we found a way for the submission roulette. So we are in space. We should use space. So we came up with a new idea. We will eject paper. So bear with me. There's a problem. So reviewer number two will have an additional power. It will be able to set the paper into a re-unsubmittable state. And all the information on that paper will be collected and ejected into a black hole. That will definitely lower the, oh, I still have 28 seconds. You hit five, oh, well, okay. How are you doing, guys? So all the paper will go inside a black hole and that's it. So we will remove, well, quite many of them, I think, but just for the sake of everything. So SpaceCrypt, send your paper. The deadline is the 31st of February, everywhere on Mars. And yeah, that's it. We are here. I mean, my 6 minute ended now. I can karaoke. Oh, yes. Yeah, right. I mean, we have plenty of bonbon here. Yeah.
Thank you. Well, it's not a joke. Maybe it is a joke, but you know. But okay. Can you move to the next? Oh, I do that. Ah, amazing. Okay. By the way, I think this humus thing is a great idea for those sprouting things. You know, one out of two memory can have only one out of two humus. There's no way you can have the second. It's a great idea. Anyway, so no, but I didn't actually. So this is just to, for the atmosphere. But I saw earlier today people and yesterday people were having problems with how to make this ideal commitment functionality FCOM fit in all kinds of protocols because you know it doesn't give you really a commitment string that you can prove your nose things or and you plug into other messages. It's too ideal. So but apparently, yeah, but we actually were dealing with the same issue in some work that we are trying to do this model analysis of commitment inside NISEC, you know, to do Fiat Shabir. So we came up with this a different way to write commitments, which is non-interactive commitment, which doesn't give you a commitment string that you can prove your knowledge things on and embed into other messages. It's great for modular analysis of non-interactive protocols and more fine-grained things. So just to say that it's possible, it's there. There are two kind of interfaces. There's the commit interface for the committer that it puts a bit or a message and gets back a commitment and a decommitment string to do what it wants with. And there is a receiver interface that it can put in an opening in the commitment. It tells him yes or no, and it just works. And it's even a little bit stronger than the normal commitment functionality, which is nice, but I also realized that, well, all the protocols that we have today for commit FCOM realize this. So I think it could be useful for people. So that's it. Thank you.
Oh, wow, the lights. Okay, hey. Good evening, everyone. So that's yet another shameless job advertisement. The place where the job will happen is a bit, I guess, unknown to people. So I will try to make it at least interesting. Let's do this. So already something shameless. I reused some memes for tonight. So, okay, it's a postdoc position. It's supposedly in a cool city, and there will be cool people there as well. And let me try to convince you of this. Okay, so first of all, the weather here. So I guess everybody here likes the sun. I guess everybody here also likes sometimes a bit of rain, but imagine having both of it at the same time, sometimes, several times a day. Well, it starts very well, I understand you. So next, you will also consider maybe the temperature. Well, imagine having both the choice of being warm and cold at the same time, not quantumly, classically, and also several times a day. Yeah, I see you coming. You want to be there. I understand you. Oh, sorry, wrong button. Let's go on the next thing. So for the sake of authenticity, I will now switch the correct language. So actually, the postdoc is happening in France, and it's in Brittany. If you do not know this region, merci. If you do not know this region, it is a very nice region on the west of France, and the city is Rennes, a very beautiful picture on the right. Then among the perks we have in France, of course, the ocean and the native forests are the very nice things. And then everybody knows the Mont Saint-Michel. This is Breton. Maybe if you're Normand, you do not agree with this, with whatever care, whoever who cares about this, it's the Mont Saint-Michel. And next thing, the food, of course. The food in Brittany is very nice. So you have crepe and galettes. This is always very nice. You can stuff a lot of things in the galette, like sausages, for example. And I bet everybody here is, or at most a huge proportion, likes butter and sugar. When it's good, because the Queen Yaman is what you're looking for. It's a lot of butter, a lot of sugar, compacted in some very nice thing. And in France, you have very nice healthcare. So don't worry, you can go for it. It's fine. Wow, tough crowd. Okay, so the next part is, so Brittany is well known for drinks. So I have listed a bunch of things. You will all find them at Rue de la Soif. So beers, of course, whiskey, everybody knows. Cider, you might know. Lambic, this is apple liqueur distilled. It's very strong. It's very good. Shushan, nobody really knows. I have been told it's honey liqueur. I hope you like it. And you can also try Pomo when you come to us to work. And it's also apple based and it's very nice. And you might end up like the guy on the bottom. That guy is not from Rennes, by the way. Okay. And to conclude this, of course, you're not here for the money. I mean, we all love science, but that's very nice, because we have actually very good salaries to offer, at least for French metrics. This is debatable. Please come to me to talk about the possibilities of the salaries, and then we'll see how it goes. And yeah, contacts here. The topic would be lattice-based signature, preferably, but I mean, we can discuss. And yeah, I guess that's it for me. So thank you.
G'day, guys. How's it going? So I'm here to talk to you about new directions in acronym-based cryptography. I like to call it ABC for short. So I'm here from ETH Zurich, or if anyone from ETH asks, I'm here from the University of Melbourne. So our motivation today is, I've noticed throughout the course of the conference this week that the short acronyms like DH, RSA, DSA, very, very boring. No one cares about that anymore. So the new and cool ones, we've got NISX, we've got ZK Snarks, we've got Stark, Snags, NDSA, Ring LWE, Snitrip 761X2. Yeah, right? So they're much longer. So that's our motivation today. I've noticed that the more letters you have, the better your crypto system is likely to be. So I'm here to study, and I study cryptographic frameworks. So universal composability, constructive cryptography. I'm looking at how to define these in a nice mathematical way. I'd like to thank Ron Carnetti for contributions to UC. So there is some prior work in this space. We have from Jan Kamenisch and et al. IUC, and we have from our very own ETH, Dennis Hofheinz and Victor Schupp, GNUC. So these are, you know, three letters, four letters, that's certainly better than two letters. Can we improve upon this result? So the first thing, you can trivially extend the acronym by just making it universally composable cryptography. Easy, UCC. Now, I'm a fan of homotopy type theory. I think it's a great candidate for a foundation of mathematics. And we have this idea in homotopy type theory called the univalence axiom. And it says, okay, so we have Turing machines X and Y. They may not be equal. They might have different states, different alphabets, but they compute the same thing. So they're equivalent, they're isomorphic. Univalence says equivalence is equality. And if you would like, you can read whatever the hell this says on NCATLAB. So we have univalent, universally composable cryptography. We get another C by using constructive logic. So this is excluding the law of the excluded middle. We don't assume that for all P, we have P or not P. This is not to be confused with constructive cryptography. This is constructive logic cryptography. So we have UUCCC. Okay, we're getting somewhere. Now, another key insight. Well, we know that a functionality UC emulates another one, and we've got this approximately, yeah, whatever. It's a pre-order, which means it's a category. So we have univalent, universally composable, categorical, constructive logic cryptography. So it turns out category theory has a use other than being able to say smart-ass things like a monad is an endofunctor in the category, a monad in the category of endofunctors, all this rubbish. So we can actually do even better than this. You would think this is an upper bound, but no. It turns out, well, okay, these arrows are really reductions, right? We're showing that you can reduce an attack on F to an attack on an ideal functionality G. There might be multiple reductions. Some of them might be tighter than others. So we actually have higher order reductions, a pre-order on reductions, or to use the categorical speak, we have a two morphism, which forms a two category, which I like to call UUCCCCC, univalent, universally composable, two categorical constructive logic cryptography. But of course, and this is really the reason I wanted to present this to you tonight, we go even further. We really take research to the next level here. You can do this as many times as you want. So our fundamental result I'm presenting, it's called UCCCCCCC. You get the idea. Univalent, universally composable, infinity categorical constructive logic cryptography. And again, you can read this on NCATLAB. I have no idea what it says, so don't ask me. Are there any questions?
Well, yay! I don't have any slides because I was up last night deploying Snarks to production, real world cryptography. yesterday at 7:45 p.m. local time, Halo 2 ZK Snarks, next generation ZK Snarks with no trusted setup to replace Groth 16 proofs in the Zcash private blockchain cryptocurrency were deployed. And we had, thank you, I heard one woo, as part of our latest network upgrade. This was the first network upgrade for Zcash that had two independent implementations of the Zcash protocol, and only one of them didn't need to be restarted when the network upgrade activated. That was mine. this is very exciting because you don't need a trusted setup for your Goth 16 zero knowledge snark or ZK snark anymore. We can just make changes to the circuit if needed for security reasons or improvement reasons, and not have to do a big powers of tau trusted setup anymore. Yay! Also, we cut a release of the Frost specification that Liz mentioned earlier, like 3 hours ago, for the IETF. Version 5 is available. If you Google CFRG Frost, that's where you can find Frost functional round optimal Schnorr threshold signatures, two rounds with to get your very nice threshold signature based on anything that has an elliptic curve group in the hash function. That's it.
Hello, everyone. Wait, probably just held it the wrong way. There we go. I am also here to present my recent work. Very proud of this. And as you can see, it says here first edition. So I am happy to announce that I will be bothering you with dubious poems for years to come, hopefully, in your next drum session as well. Like any artist, I will start with a self-portrait about how I ended up here. Yeah, let's get cracking. The world premiere. I asked and I begged and I pled. Please accept my paper, I said. Zero accepts, three hard rejects. So I went with poems instead. Thank you. I'd like to remind you that with like this poetic society, we don't usually clap. We do this. Thank you. Okay, so but even though I didn't get the paper here, the department was kind enough to give me travel money to go here. Yeah. And when I got there, I had the pleasure of meeting this world-renowned famous cryptographer. And as any new PhD student, I wanted to show her that, of course, I keep up with ePrint. I'm a serious scientist. Yeah. So this is inspired by that talk. I'm sorry you're out there. And yeah, this is a confession. You know who you are. Your work has had such a huge impact. It changed my whole life, in fact. She started to glow. But little did she know that I had only glanced at the abstract. Thank you. Finally, we get to an important topic. Let's get serious here. Yeah, when you sit in on all these talks, I'm hopefully not the only one who feels this way. And I now present my most proud work because it comes with a twist. This one's definitely not true, but I would like it to be. This talk had me lost at slide 3. So I asked an esteemed attendee. He tried to explain, but it was all in vain because he was even more lost than me. Thank you.
Okay, so this drum session is approaching its end. And it's time to announce the name, the next Eurocrypt. Some of you who were at the membership meeting already know where it's happening. And for those who weren't, it's happening in France, in the beautiful city of Lyon. So from here, you get a view of the old town in Lyon, of Lyon, from one of the two main hills of the city and one of the two rivers. We have everything twice there. So the workshop is going to happen as usual over 1 week. First, the workshops on 2 days, 22 and 23 of April, and then the main event, 24 to 27 of April. It's going to be hosted by ENS Lyon. The general chair is Damien Stellet, who's somewhere in the room, I guess. And the general co-chairs are Alain Pasleg and myself. And you can come by train. It's Lyon happens to be fairly well connected with the rest of Europe. Even if you're here in Trondheim, it's less than a 2 day trip, so you have no excuse. And if you happen to be from another continent, well, we do have an international airport, which may be convenient for some of you. It's going to happen in this convention center. Here you see the second river, and just next to the convention center, you have a very beautiful park. Lyon is a UNESCO World Heritage City. It's very beautiful, very nice to walk in. And most importantly, it is very well known for its food, world-renowned culinary arts tradition, very long history in gastronomy. This is the most important slide, so I want to keep talking about this. But well, anyway, we're very looking forward to see you all in Lyon next year.
Right. Can you hear me?
No.
No? Yeah. Okay. Oh,
singing. Ah.
I think we have. Yeah. Maybe I made a typo. It says the things we learned when we were in Trondheim. I think it's meant to be, oh, the things we learned when we were in Trondheim. Okay. So, yeah. We've a short song, but the things we learned when we were in Trondheim. So there's music, I think. Get it? Yeah.
I think we're supposed to get some song now.
Yes. So you're all very welcome to sing along. Bit of an intro. Louder, yeah.
Multi-party combination, more multi-party combination. Open up the bags of tricks across one session of five or six. An organ concert now and then. Indeed, our old church, amen. Bach was in D minor, but the organ pipes were major. Many hours of daytime. All the things we learned when we were in Trondheim.
Ready?
Everyone, you're a crypt 2022, sunshine, fjords, and mountains too. Lattice, problems, FHE, the sun is up by 3:30. We've all come to Trondheim for the week to prevent information leak. I hear it's good for networking, but the beer they cost 10 euros. It's almost a crime. What a thing we learned when we were in Trondheim. Multi-party combination, more multi-party combination. Open up the bag of tricks across one session or five or six. An organ concert now and then in the Darrow's church, amen. Back was in D minor, but the organ pipes were major. And the hours of big time, oh, the things we learned when we were in Trondheim. All the things we learned when we were in Trondheim. All the things we learned when we were in Trondheim.
What?
Well, don't get up yet, no worries. As Sophia said earlier, there's a bit more that will happen. So we have the honor, and we weren't really prepared, so there are no slides for that. We have the honor to hand over this beautiful present for the best rum session talk. We have to figure out though which one is the best rum session talk. And we might be a bit biased, and you all know if you want to reduce bias, we just have a bigger sample. So you all will be helping us to find this out. So there have been a lot of great talks. So in order to reduce this a bit down, I think we will go session by session and then get figure out what was the best session and get the best speakers from that session on stage and then hand over the prize. So.
Yeah, there's way too many good talks here, but hopefully you all remember what happened when. If not, you can look at your phone as a reminder. The program is on the website. All right, so what we're gonna do is we're gonna announce session one, session two, and session three. We're gonna ask you guys to clap. Whichever session receives the loudest applause, we're gonna select the final winner from. So take a couple seconds, remember what happened when, okay? Are you ready? Okay, that was a lot of no's. I'm gonna count down from 10. Look at your phones, no pressure. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay, are you ready now? Oh, no. Let's do it again. That's fine. We're gonna do this. All right. Session one. Go ahead. Okay. Session one was great. Session two. This is hard to beat. Session three. All right, guys, it sounds like it's session three. We still have six contenders.
Oh Lord, what did we do when we made the program?
I know.
So we're going to get one of the presenters on stage for each of the talks that were considered funny in the third session. And then we'll do the same thing again recursively until we found the best talk. So first in session three was Nadim and all. So Nadim, can you please come on stage and represent Humoscript?
I just like to mention there are direct flights from Israel to Lyon that can withstand hummus in very good condition. So I think next time, none of us will have excuses. So I hope.
Nadim, can you please say? Okay, next one would be from the talk by Elena, Carlo, and Lorenzo about SpaceCrypt. Elena, can you please come on stage?
Come and visit! Touché.
Apply for a postdoc.
Ooh. Oh no! Okay, I've been waiting to mispronounce this name all night. Alexander Wallet, please come on stage for postdoctoral positions, Renee, and Lattice State Signatures.
Well, no prize for Alexander then.
Ah, there he is. Well.
All right. Then we have Eleanor McMurdy, representing New Directions in acronym-based cryptography.
Okay, well, me again.
Yeah, I don't like the stuff either, I understand that. Okay, then we had Jonathan, who talked about Limericks from the Heart, the first edition. Jonathan. Jonathan, what is your opinion about salty licorice? What is your opinion about salty licorice?
Sorry,
this stuff.
Oh, yeah, I love the limpy and the
coffee. Well, and last but not least, from the CWI and Leiden Choir about the fantastic song we heard last. Can somebody come on stage, please? Okay, six talks, so we have to find out who was the best. I guess we will be the totally unbiased judges based on...
Wait, we should do like a binary search.
Okay, okay. Oh, let's do a binary. Oh, it's six people. It's going to be complicated.
Yeah, it's not going to be easy. But we can start with the right half and the left half. Okay. It's, oh, I never know what right and left is. This half and that half. Okay, let's start with this half. And now we have that half.
I think you guys had a conflict of interest, so that doesn't count. I think it was the first ones. No, what do you guys think? Sorry, I guess, you know.
All right. I guess we go from right to left. Left to right?
I guess left to right. I guess we start in order of size. We begin with Elena. Then we had Nadim. Last but not least, the licorice loving Jonathan. Well, we unbiased judges are now going to do a secure two-party computation to find out who won. So, Sophia, who do you think should get the prize? It's, yeah, it's not secure against the pitch, so, you know. it sounded to me, and you might agree, and to Sophia too, like Jonathan should get the prize.
And one moment, over there is our Viking, that is Magnus, the Magnificent, that is gonna hand you the prize. The drink of the gods.
Extra poem. Before we stop this thing, can I please ask Bo on stage again? Bo. So it might look like we have organized all this stuff here for you, but it was actually Bo.
So I don't know what goes.
Thank you very much. Yes, I'd like to thank everyone who contributed to this great rum session, the people from the crypto group at NTNU who helped, all the volunteers at Somfund who helped manning the bars, manning the sound, manning the light, manning the video, the security guards, of course, Karsten and Sophia. Been a pleasure, and of course also Snausken, who played for us when we came in, and LSL, who are going to play for us now. So before we're going to move over to the after party, we're going to do a really quick changeover. We're going to take out the roughly first 5-6 rows of seats, so everyone sitting there is kindly requested to drift because we need a dance floor. But wait a second. And then while we're doing that, I should also say that the bar next door will stay open, so people that want to kind of shy away from the dance floor a bit can go there and hang out a bit and grab another beer. And also the people that want to get rid of their bags during the dancing can use the coat check downstairs, which is open. Thank you very much, and we're going to, Colin is going to say a few words, and the after party is going to start in 5 to 10 minutes.
Just want to say that. If you want to get a bus back to the Clarion, there'll be buses going, if you want to, every 30 minutes, starting at 4 minutes. But they only go every half hour, and they're only going to wait for 5 minutes because of the parking situation. You have to look for V Tourbus. Yeah, okay. 10:30, 11:30, 12. Otherwise, you're on your own.